Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present The Maker of Moons by Robert W. Chambers. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. I am myself just as much evil as good, and my nation is, and I say there is in fact no evil. Or if there is, I say it is just as important to you, to the land, or to me, as anything else. Each is not for its own sake. I say the whole earth and all the stars in the sky are for religion's sake. I say no man has ever yet been half devout enough. None has ever yet adored or worshipped half enough. None has begun to think how divine he himself is and how certain the future is. Walt Whitman. The Maker of Moons. I have heard what the talkers were talking, the talk of the beginning and the end, but I do not talk of the beginning or the end. 1. Concerning Yulao and the Shin, I know nothing more than you shall know. I am miserably anxious to clear the matter up. Perhaps what I write may save the United States government money and lives. Perhaps it may arouse the scientific world to action. At any rate, it will put an end to the terrible suspense of two people. Certainty is better than suspense. If the government dares to disregard this warning and refuses to send a thoroughly equipped expedition at once, the people of the state may take swift vengeance on the whole region and leave a blackened, devastated waste where today forest and flowering meadowland border the lake and the cardinal woods. You already know part of the story. The New York papers have been full of alleged details. This much is true. Barris caught the Shiner red-handed, or rather yellow-handed, for his pockets and boots and dirty fists were stuffed with lumps of gold. I say gold advisedly. You may call it what you please. You also know how Barris was, but unless I begin at the beginning of my own experiences, you will be none the wiser after all. On the 3rd of August of this present year, I was standing in Tiffany's, chatting with George Godfrey of the designing department. On the glass counter between us lay a coiled serpent, an exquisite specimen of chiseled gold. "No," replied Godfrey to my question, "it isn't my work. I wish it was." "Why, man, it's a masterpiece." "Whose?" I asked. "Now, I should be very glad to know also," said Godfrey. "We bought it from an old jay who says he lives in the country somewhere about the Cardinal Woods. That's near Starlit Lake, I believe." "Lake of the Stars," I suggested. "Some call it Starlit Lake. It's all the same. Well, my rustic Reuben says that he represents the sculptor of this snake for all practical and business purposes. He got his prize, too. We hope he'll bring us something more. We have sold this already to the Metropolitan Museum." I was leaning idly on the glass case, watching the keen eyes of the artist in precious metals as he stooped over the gold serpent. "A masterpiece," he muttered to himself, fondling the glittering coil. "Look at the texture. Whew!" But I was not looking at the serpent. Something was moving, crawling out of Godfrey's coat pocket, the pocket nearest to me. Something soft and yellow, with crab-like legs all covered with coarse yellow hair. "What in heaven's name," said I, "have you got in your pocket? It's crawling out. It's trying to creep up your coat, Godfrey." He turned quickly and dragged the creature out with his left hand. I shrank back as he held the repulsive object dangling before me, and he laughed and placed it on the counter. "Did you ever see anything like that?" he demanded. "No," said I truthfully. "And I hope I never shall again. What is it?" "I don't know." "Ask them at the Natural History Museum. They can't tell you. The Smithsonian is all at sea, too. It is, I believe, the connecting link between a sea urchin, a spider, and a devil. It looks venomous, but I can't find either fangs or mouth. Is it blind? These things may be eyes, but they look as if they were painted. A Japanese sculptor might have produced such an impossible beast, but it is hard to believe that God did. It looks unfinished, too. I have a mad idea that this creature is only one of the parts of some..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.